Hey, YouTube golf fans, Herman Williams here with HermanWilliamsGolf.com and the Get Hermanized project. I'm going to work on getting you Hermanized again here today with a full discussion of swing plane. And I know I've already done some videos on YouTube that we've got a takeaway video that kind of discusses how you'd get on plane. We've got some downswing videos that talk about how to get on plane. But today, I'm going to try to just tie all of it together, define the swing plane for you, tell you what it is, where it is, how to get there, the whole nine yards. So, and if you'll stick around to the end of the video, we'll show you a few swings here at the end with some lines drawn, you know, kind of let you reference, you know, what you really should look for those of you that are out there doing some of your own film. So, first of all, let me step off camera and grab an alignment stick so we can kind of explain what we're looking for. So, you know, we see all types of stuff on Golf Channel, YouTube, everywhere talking about swing plane. But if I just kind of step out of the picture and put a golf club here, what I'm going to call plane one is you've got the initial swing plane of the golf club itself. You know, that's the actual shaft line that would extend off into space. And I'm now going to kind of step here to the side of that and let you see that. That would be an extremely flat plane to play golf on. And I know those of you that maybe look at somebody like a Matt Kuchar and you've heard things like the one-plane swing or the two-plane swing, you might think that the golf club is going to stay on that plane. I would tell you for almost everybody I've ever stood in front of, that plane is possibly flat to stay on. You will not see even the one-planer stay exactly on the original shaft plane. And you probably could go out there right now and find somebody and contradict me, but in general, it'd be pretty tough to do. And one of the big reasons is because we have a two-armed connection to the golf club separated by the space of our shoulders. When we look at how the arms are going to swing, let me get rid of this alignment stick real quick. When we look at how the arms are going to swing, we could stay on plane one pretty easily with one arm, but if I attach the second arm, I can barely stay there. I'm just going to finish a backswing that's right along my waist. As I would continue on with a two-armed attachment, it's going to rise above that first plane and move on to what I'm going to call here plane two. And let me grab the stick again. So what we would see is when you go into plane two, so to speak, it's well above plane one. And I was just given a lesson a couple of days ago that motivated me to come put this YouTube video together because the player was under the impression that it would probably be one plane all the time, and they could just point the butt of the golf club at the golf ball and everything would be safe in the downswing. And this particular player was a, quote, two-plane player who started out on plane one and then rose into plane two at the top, which is perfectly okay. A little bit shorter stature player who's going to be a little bit more upright kind of posture, or even a taller player who chooses to play that way, is almost always going to have the shoulders moving on a fairly level plane, and the golf club is going to move through plane one and then rise up to plane two. He didn't realize that, and what he was missing was as he would start the downswing, it was always over the top because he could never find a way to arrive back down on plane one. So what I want to describe for you is when we're doing video analysis, the way we try to look at swing plane is we recognize that backswings are typically, unless you're a pure one-planer where you're really tall, bent over a lot, that kind of player is going to attempt to get the shoulder line, the arm swing line, the shaft line, everything onto a single plane back to the golf ball. And I say attempt because it's almost never perfect, but it will get pretty close to where the shift from plane two to plane one is not that great. It may be pretty small. Historically, probably over a 100-year period, there have been more players who have played the two-plane golf where you're standing a little more erect at setup, the shoulders are coming around a little bit more level, club moves through waist-high backswing, and then rises up. Now, that's a swing where the arms are lifting up above the shoulders. They're on a separate plane to the shoulders. Both methods are fine. They're both pretty effective. You just need to understand which one you are and link up the ideas so that they'll work well for you. So to be successful as a one-plane player, let's talk about that real quick. If I think benefits taller players because you can naturally get into a posture that gets your spine over the golf ball. Let me roll this ball up in front of me a little bit here. It gets your spine over the ball, and as I said earlier, it allows you to make a pivot now that has your shoulder line more closely aimed at the golf ball. And I say closely, it won't be directly at it. I think Jim Hardy mentioned somewhere anywhere from 2 feet out to at the golf ball. The arm swing itself, if you look at my left arm angle, it closely matches a plane back to the golf ball, and then the shaft itself would do the same. Well, that type of player has really the geometry, you know, the geometry, if you will, lines up so that everything in the upper body package is going to just rotate and move back to the golf ball. So that swing is very rotary, very posture dependent, good simple geometry. Means you got to have a pretty good lower back to stand in that posture and be able to pivot, but it actually doesn't put any additional stress on your back during the rest of the golf swing. If I turn to face the camera, simple wind up, pretty tight rotation, there's not much weight shift anywhere, pretty tight rotation back through the shot, and then on through the finish. All right, second version of the swing, the two-plane player, is now going to be in a taller posture at setup. Going to move through a waist-high kind of one-piece takeaway that's still on original plane one. Then in my takeaway video, I mentioned how the arms are going to rise and rotate. So the club is going to move off plane one and start to move into a parallel plane that is above that original shaft plane and then move into the top of the swing. Now this player is going to make a downswing move that's a little bit different. It's going to involve a little bit more lateral shifting. This is kind of our bump to the target, backing into the target. I've got a video on that. And during that process, the arms are falling to reattach to plane one. This is where most people miss it. They begin aggressively clearing, turning the body, fly right over plane one, and chop back through it over the top. And you've got to have that moment. I'll admit, a Rory McIlroy, very aggressive hips. He's simply skilled at getting this drop to go to plane one. He's able to turn his body aggressively and make the drop, but most people will fail to do it. Start turning, go right over. So I'm not going to tell you clearing is wrong or you can't do it. I'm just going to warn you that if it's the only thing you're thinking about, you might never reconnect with plane one on your way down. So for a two-planer, ideally, you've got to have this little moment in time where you make the shift, the arms passively fall, the shaft itself is drifting down parallel to the plane. If you get too aggressive here at yanking the handle down, it'll get steep. You'll probably reconnect the butt of the club to plane one, but the shaft plane itself will be all wrong. It'll be too steep, probably still crash. You want kind of a passive, sort of a free-falling action that just lets the shaft fall into plane one, and now you can really pour on the gas, let the hips clear, let the right arm begin to thrust if you're a right-handed player, and you'll see your full extension going beyond impact. So I hope that, you know, I hope that didn't confuse you, but I hope it also adds a little bit of detail and gives you some options. You've got a choice to play as a one-plane player, choice to play as a two-plane player, and then of course there's hybrid players that fit somewhere in between. I mean, there's no exact perfect swing plane that everybody's got to go adopt, but you've got to get it to fit you and you've got to understand how it operates. The tendency is to think that there's just one plane for that whole club to move on. It's not quite that way. Most of us tend to get a little above it, drop to it, and then swing. Others will stay closer to a one-plane model. The one thing I would tell you when we do our downswing analysis, as the horsepower increases and the speed of the swing really starts to ramp up, you're going to see just the pure physics of it tend to try to draw a straight line from the top of the swing to the golf ball. And because of that, I've found that I think to have great success, players that carry their hands really low at setup and let the arms really hang in close to the body have a hard time staying there. The natural weight of the club as it speeds up tends to rise here. So I advocate a little bit simpler version of that swing would be to let the hands start a bit higher and away from the body. And then what you will often see is that the full speed, full horsepower downswings, the plane begins to look like some kind of hybrid that's between plane one and two. It tends to go from where the hosel of the club started out, put it behind the ball here, and it tends to go right through the right elbow, so it's a little bit steeper than the original shaft line. I'm talking about the downswing plane right now. And that would match up to going like right through my sternum and right on out my body. So when you really look, high horsepower, high speed downswings that really run free, they don't return to the exact shaft line. They turn with the handle a little bit above that. And it, generally, if you're trying to draw lines on V1 or something like that, if you draw a line from the neck of the club, make it pass through your right elbow, and keep going out in space, if you can stay on that line for a downswing, you're probably doing a pretty good job. If you stay slightly underneath it, okay, you'll probably hit a little bit of a push draw. If you're over it, I'd say you want to get to work on that and really try to fix it.
Okay, so as promised, I told you I would try to get a tour player swing on screen here to kind of talk about the various swing planes we've discussed in the video. So I've got Paul Casey on screen here. This is from several years back at the original driving range down at Augusta. And what you'll see if you look over here on the left, we've got plane one drawn out, which is the shaft plane at setup. We have an intermediate plane, which is kind of this middle red line that's going to be the typical downswing plane that you'll find, particularly for a two-plane swinger. And then we've got plane two up above. So let's just kind of go ahead and walk through the swing itself and watch how it evolves. So we get into takeaway. You can see how the hands drift along the lower plane line. Then we see the arms begin to rise and move toward plane two. You see how the butt end of the handle sits right on plane two there. And now Paul is going to make that typical move we see particularly for two plane type swingers, where there's a little squat with kind of a bump or a shift to the left side. And that's where the arms drop. They fall to this intermediate plane. And frankly, what starts to happen is there's so much centrifugal force and speed that the club would never really return to plane one unless the player is almost consciously manipulating it to do that, because the forces are going to try to line up more with the center of the torso or the shoulder socket. So as we see here, the hands run down this intermediate plane line. You can see how the club head kind of sits somewhere between plane one and the intermediate plane, which shows that it'll strike from the inside, as we like to reference in a lot of our teaching videos. And as we move into impact, you can see how the hands are higher than they were on plane one. They're a little bit farther away from the body, definitely striking on an in to out path. And then the exit again is somewhere between the intermediate plane and plane two. Now this is for a player that's going to be hitting a little bit from the inside, particularly with a driver. It'll be kind of an inside to upward approach path. But I just thought that would give you some insight into how the plane lines fit and how golf is rarely played on just one shaft plane. You hear the label one plane swing thrown out there, but that's more of an indicator for how the arms, shoulders, and club shaft swing on a similar plane due to how we set up the body. But the shaft itself rarely moves on exactly one plane throughout the golf swing. Okay, so here we have Ian Poulter, same Masters tournament, and it's not a perfect camera angle, but you can see how I've set up the lines. We've got shaft plane, plane one, intermediate plane in the middle, and then plane two up at the top. Let's watch his takeaway. And you can see Ian's got fairly elaborate, he's got camera set up there doing some checking on his swing. And again, this is a couple of years back. This is not 2013 or 2014, but you can see how he does a pretty good job of sort of flowing along plane one as he starts to take away. Then things shift a little bit above. But that's not a super upright backswing. You look at his right elbow, it's fairly low. His left arm is a little bit above the left shoulder, but not drastically so. And he's got a pretty deep torso angle. You know, you look at his average body angle here, he's fairly bent over the shot. So, you know, this would, for a lot of you, would feel like a pretty flat golf swing. Now we'll watch the hands drop, and Ian makes a significant drop. He really gets it moving down very close to plane one, and you will see some players capable of doing that. But I want you to watch as the shaft angle evolves into impact, how it is a steeper angle at the strike than what the address position was. The hands are up a little bit higher, sort of just above plane one, and if you look at that line, it would extend, you know, through the let's look back at setup, see how that line goes from the hosel of the club through the right elbow through the sternum of the body. So you're usually going to see an average like that. So typically, if I'm doing a swing analysis on a student to keep things less confusing, I will simply draw that one red line, and I want to see the shaft move a little bit underneath that. And again, this video is not tripod mounted, so you see a little bit of wiggle there at the start. Shaft will start out under the line, move just above it, and then return to it. And that return would be indication to me that we've got a pretty efficient downswing with pretty good power, because the player is not trying to hold the hands lower than average and trying to return to plane one. And, you know, if you look in the middle of the takeaway, or I'm sorry, the middle of the downswing, you can see how he's definitely approaching from underneath the plane, so he'll get a slight in to out striking, and then you'll see the release extend just a little bit above that plane line, so that's a, you know, a little bit higher finish there. So hopefully this explanation of swing plane has helped you, and seeing some of the tour swings on the video gives you just a little bit more reference, particularly for those of you that are out there using V1 or some of the other apps to help study your own golf swings. Okay, and now we have a swing that probably everybody will recognize in any discussion about swing plane. We have Matt Kuchar on the screen here. He's hitting an iron. Again, this is a couple of years back, so you see the lines that I've drawn now look a little bit different. We've got the lower line, which we'll call plane one, which is the shaft plane. Then we have the intermediate line, which comes through the right elbow. And then the short line I have up near his shoulder blade is just going to be the exit path of the shaft. So let's go ahead and play Matt's swing, which would be probably the closest that everybody would look for out on the tour as a quote one plane swinger. He's fairly tall, bows over the golf ball a pretty fair amount, and has a what people assume is a fairly flat arm swing. We'll probably see how it looks quite similar when you really put it all together. So let's go ahead and play this swing now. So you can see how takeaway moves a little bit underneath plane one. Hands stay well to the inside. Shaft comes a little inside. I think honestly now Matt keeps the club head a little bit more out in front of him than that. You know, you see where the club head is now there. I think now it's a little bit more out in this area. But that's not really the part of the swing we're trying to highlight. So let's carry on up. So you can see now he arrives into that plane one position. And notice right where the club finishes at the top of the backswing, the butt end of the golf club is literally right on that intermediate plane that we talked about. Now the two plane players are well above that. You'll see their arm swings, for particularly the left arm, would be somewhere up in this range parallel to plane one. He's probably somewhere about halfway. Notice how the right elbow sits on plane one, very low, very much like maybe a Ben Hogan would have been. So let's watch what the downswing does. Now you notice the butt of the golf club moves immediately onto the intermediate plane, then sinks just slightly beneath it, kind of splits the difference between the intermediate plane and plane one. And then as we begin to arrive at impact, you can see how the club works out in front of him, and there we see the shaft again on the intermediate plane that, as we drew it originally, moves through the right elbow. So I think you guys can see how, regardless of where you put yourself in a swing plane conversation, one planer, two planer, hybrid of the two, if you learn to look for that intermediate plane that goes from the hosel of the golf club through the right elbow and through the sternum, you can do a very good job of starting to analyze a golf swing with just a single plane line sitting on the screen. So let's just finish this description here with the exit position. As we see the club extend down the line, release here, you can see how the shaft exits just a little bit above the original two planes. So again, the sign of a swing that's moving a little bit from in to out as it strikes the golf ball, and then up into the finish.
Okay gang, I hope that helps you out. Hopes it gives you a full understanding of swing plane. If there's something I missed there, please sure to put it in the comments. We'll try to address it in the next video. You know the deal. Till next time, I'm Herman Williams, and you've just been Hermanized.